Hello friends, welcome to another episode of My Engineering Today, and we'll be presenting three updates with you all. We'll start with Starship, followed by an update on Northrop Grumman's new satellite, and at the end we'll take a look at how China is denying their involvement in the rocket stage destined for the lunar lander impact. Let's get started with the SpaceX plans to send some of their retired Starships to local Texas airport for public viewing. SpaceX's Starbase, Starship Factory, which is the heart of Starship development, is already a well-bred tourist destination, specifically for the fans of space travel and space rockets in Brownsville, Texas, and the local Rio Grande Valley. The Boca Chica factory, with three launch pads, is almost situated close to a public highway as well as the small private housing development and the public beach, thus providing nearly all the features for being grown up as a place of tourist attraction. But on the other hand, SpaceX has been facing a consistent challenge for maintaining access to all of these. Recently, SpaceX CEO Elon Musk has spoken about turning a retired Starship prototype into a public exhibit near Brownsville, South Padre Island International Airport. On the 21st of February, 2022, S. Padre wrote to Musk, "Sure would be cool to have a Starship in a public rocket garden for SpaceX fans, maybe at the entrance to the island or somewhere." Musk replied, "If South Padre and or Brownsville would like a Starship prototype, we can send one over." He also wrote, "Maybe near BRO Airport, since that serves both communities." Elon Musk has recently reiterated that SpaceX is committed to maintain their strong presence in the Boca Chica region, whether or not the U.S. government gives them the necessary permission for regular Starship launches. And the recent announcement emboldens this step further. Musk's eagerness to donate an entire Starship prototype to a local organization certainly demonstrates that commitment. The public exhibit is planned to situate near the airport, as it will make it easy for visiting fans or other prospective visitors to drive for half an hour and get a close-up of Starship. SpaceX has an increasing supply of retired or fully unused Starship and Super Heavy vehicles, and this makes them a large choosing option to send which one for the public exhibit. For the creation of such an exhibit, the major barrier would be transfer to and placing of these huge rockets on massive foundations. To gain access all the way to the Brownsville International Airport, it's expected that a number of power lines and traffic lights would have to be moved from place, creating minor inconvenience, and SpaceX will need certain help from local administration for this work. Starship SN15 was the first ship prototype to survive a soft landing in mid-2021. It was planned that SN15 would be reused on a second flight test, but it never happened. SN15 now stays retired in the Starbase rocket garden. SN16 also was retired and sent to the garden before it ever got to perform a single test. In the recent context, Ship 22 was also retired from prior use, and Booster 5 was also sent to the rocket garden without even completing it. Let's move to our next update, where Space Logistics is planning to launch a new satellite servicing mission in the year 2024. On the 21st of February, Space Logistics, a satellite servicing company owned by Northrop Grumman, declared their latest plans for sending a newer satellite servicing mission to orbit set for the year 2024. As per reports, the mission will be carried out on a SpaceX rocket. Joseph Anderson, the Vice President of Space Logistics, stated that the mission robotic vehicle was built with many of the same technologies also used in their mission extension vehicles, or rather known as MEVs. At present, two MEVs in orbit are currently providing station-keeping services for two Intelsat geostationary satellites that have low fuel, quite a time before. This latest satellite servicer mission will be the first launch of Northrop Grumman's most recent and upgraded mission robotic vehicle. This MRV spacecraft, equipped with a robotic arm, will install propulsion jetpacks on dying satellites. As per reports, this latest MRV is designed to stay operational in orbit for 10 years. According to some sources, Australia's promising satellite operator, Optus, is the first client for the mission robotic vehicle. The robotic arm for the MRV spacecraft was developed by the U.S. Naval Research Laboratory. This development was mainly funded by the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, or rather known as DARPA. For the 2024 Satellite Servicer mission, Northrop Grumman is assembling the MRV and three mission extension pods at their facility in Dulles, Virginia. Report says that the mission extension pods are capable of increasing the service life of a 2,000-kilogram satellite by almost 6 years. Anderson said that all three pods will launch in 2024, along with the MRV spacecraft for the mission. First of all, the MRV will install one mission extension pod in the Optus satellite, and the other two are for other customer satellites. Names of other two customers have not been revealed yet. Though Space Logistics owns and has full control over their MRV vehicle, they prefer to sell their mission extension pods as products to customers, and thus these MEPs will be owned and operated by the client who purchases it. Anderson said the company targets to install as many as 30 propulsion pods over the life of their mission robotic vehicle. He said, "Our manifest for the MRV is full through mid-2026. Until now, Space Logistics has not disclosed the price tag of their MRV services. Reports have come out that, besides Optus, five more clients have signed term sheets to purchase mission extension pods. As per sources, the MRV vehicle will have a weight of 3,000-kilogram spacecraft, and while the mission extension pods will have a weight of 400 kilograms each, after launch, the MRV and MEPs will be released from a launch vehicle, and then they will independently deploy and raise themselves to a geostationary orbit using solar electric propulsion. Once in orbit, MEP will be captured by the MRV and then transported to the client satellite. The MRV vehicle will carry on rendezvous and docks with the client to install the mission extension pods. Then the MRV detaches itself and moves on to grab another MEP for the next customer." Anderson said, "We removed the docking mechanism and replaced it with the robotic payload from DARPA. And the way we attach the MEP to the client vehicle with a docking mechanism, that also has direct heritage and from the mission extension vehicle, clearly there's a significant debris issue in low Earth orbit that one day will need to be addressed. Everything we're doing today for satellite servicing in GEO can be directly applied to debris mitigation in low Earth orbit or to other services there, if and when customers decide to pay for those types of services." In our next update, China states that the moon-hitting rocket part was not from their Chang'e 5 mission. On the 21st of February, China's Foreign Ministry spokesman Wang Wenbin said, "According to China's monitoring, the upper stage of the rocket related to the Chang'e 5 mission entered into Earth's atmosphere and completely burned up. According to China's Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the moon-hitting rocket part was not from their Chang'e 5 T1 mission, which was carried out in 2014, almost 8 years ago." Another space organization, Space Force's 18th Space Control Squadron, which tracks data of launches, re-entries, breakup of the rocket parts, stated that the booster stage of Chinese Long March 3C rocket, which is assumed to hit the moon, had actually re-entered into Earth's atmosphere just a year after launch in 2015. And this statement also supports the recent claim, which China's Ministry of Foreign Affairs has stated. On the 21st of January 2022, astronomer Bill Gray said that an object designated WE0913A was on a trajectory that would collide with the moon on the 4th of March. Gray initially associated the debris with the February 2015 Falcon 9 launch of the Deep Space Climate Observatory. On the 12th of February, Gray revised the identification of WE0913A with another suggestion that the broken rocket debris matches with the upper stage of a Long March 3C rocket stage that was launched during China's Chang'e 5 T1 mission in 2014. He wrote, "In a sense, this remains circumstantial evidence." A similar statement was found from NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory's Center for Near-Earth Object Studies. Moreover, students from the University of Arizona stated that the moon-hitting part is most likely from China's Long March 3C rocket. Though the recent statements from China tries to establish the fact that the moon-hitting rocket part was not from their Chang 5 mission, confusion remains as they mainly referred to Chang 5 rather than Chang 5 T1 mission specifically. So a question remains. Chang 5 T1 was a trial mission for a more ambitious lunar sample return mission. It successfully tested a high-velocity spacecraft skip re-entry after returning from the moon, verifying a re-entry capsule would safely deliver lunar rocks to Earth. Wang said, "China's aerospace endeavors are always in keeping with international law. We are committed to earnestly safeguarding the long-term sustainability of outer space activities and are ready to have extensive exchanges and cooperation with all sides." Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.